Amen. Aren't you glad we serve a God that's right on time? He knows exactly what we need. He's right there on time, and He's well able to supply every need, to give us strength to continue walking down this path of life. And you know, the Christian life is not an easy path. You know, it's not for, how do I want to put it, for sissies. You know, it's not a romper room, if you will. It's a battlefield. And we've been enlisted in the army of God, and sometimes we get weary. Sometimes we get tired, and we need some help along the way, and I'm so thankful. He's always there to give us what we need. We don't need to quit. We don't need to back up. We just need to continue plugging along, and He'll supply every need, and He'll see us through if we trust Him with all our heart. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct our paths. And I'm so thankful for that. Tonight is going to be a little unusual message, and you can probably figure that out by looking on the podium here. He's going to be my helper, and we'll talk about that in just a little bit, but I want you to take your Bible and turn to the book of Exodus to begin with, and we'll be looking at one verse in the book of Exodus, and then I'm going to look at a couple other places, and then give you what the Lord placed upon my heart tonight. So Exodus chapter number 8 and verse number 20, when you find your place, Exodus chapter number 8 and verse number 20, if you'll stand to your feet, and we'll read the Word of God, and then we'll see what the Lord has for us this evening. Exodus chapter 8 and verse number 20. The Bible says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, rise up early in the morning, and stand before Pharaoh. Lo, he cometh forth to the water. And say unto him, thus saith the Lord, let my people go, that they may serve him." Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your precious word. And Lord, we thank you that those times we struggle, those times we don't understand, those times that we are facing insurmountable odds, God, if we'll go to your word, God, you've given us your love letter. God, if we'll just seek out your truths and your directions and your instructions and comfort and strength and guide, Lord, if we'll just seek your face, Lord, you said you'd help us. And Father, I pray that you'll help us tonight. Help us as we look at your word. Lord, help us to be better Christians. Help us to be a vessel suited for your purpose. And we'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You can be seated. Exodus chapter 8, verse number 20 is where the message is going to come from tonight. But I want to do a little introduction, if I may, to the message tonight. I'm going to be preaching on practical lessons for living. And you know, each one of us need practical lessons to make it in this Christian life. You say, "Preacher, give me some things that I can use every day that'll help me in my walk with the Lord. Help me to be a better Christian." You know, as we start this life as a child of God, we have a new birth, if you will. You know, when we come into this world, we have a birth, a physical birth. But then when we're born again, we have a brand new birth. And just like we were that little child that was birthed physically into this world, we're just little babes in Christ as we're born again, as we're born anew. And we have to grow. It's a learning process. A young man told me one time, he said, "I wish when I got saved, God would just screw my head off and just take His precious word and just pour it all into my head and then screw my head back on and I'd have it all." Well, it don't work like that. But we have to get it in. We have to study and we have to learn and we have to grow. And as we begin our life as a child of God, we're babes in Christ. Brand new creatures. Brand new start. Brand new life. Brand new opportunities. And we have to grow. You know, a baby just doesn't, when the moment it's born, instantly is able to chew on steak. It's not instantly able to get up and walk across the room. It's not instantly able to talk right and to walk right and to act right. Children have to grow. Well, same thing with God's children. We have to grow. But, you know, if a small child stayed in that condition as a child, we would think something was wrong with them. You know, children, there's four things you can characterize a child by. You know, a child is small. Would you agree? A little child, yeah, they're small. Children are small. When we get saved, we're small. We're not a whole lot. And you say, well, how can God ever use me? I'm just a little child, little babe in Christ. But that's the characteristics of a child. You know, you wouldn't expect a child to come out weighing 125 pounds. Ladies, that'd be rough, wouldn't it? Children are small. But if they stay small, there's a problem. Children are not only small, but children are selfish. You know, have you ever been around kids that get to playing with one another? What's one of the words they use? Mine! Mine! And they're selfish. Well, little babes in Christ, sometimes they're selfish too. That's my book. That's my chair. That's my parking place. But we can expect that, because they're babes. They're brand new creatures in Christ, and they have to grow. You know, I remember one time I went with a preacher preaching. I went with him. I helped him drive that night. And we went in, and we sat down on the front pew of the church he was going to be preaching in, and we were waiting for his time to come to preach. And we were sitting there. He was on the end of the pew, and I was right beside him. And before the service started, this elderly lady came in, and she walked up to him and greeted us and told the preacher how much she appreciated him coming and looking forward to his preaching. And then she told him, she said, but you in my seat. Well, you know, you would think eventually we get past all that, but sometimes we don't, because we hadn't grown up. So children are small. Children a whole lot of times selfish. Children a whole lot of times silly. I mean, just do crazy stuff, silly stuff. But that's because they're a child. They do silly stuff, and they also, sometimes a child is spoiled. You ever seen any spoiled children? Yeah. Well, what is a spoiled? That's a youngin' that gets its way all the time. Everybody bows down to the child. Everybody meets the needs of the child. Anything it wants, anything it desires, it's kind of sound like grandchildren, don't it? But children can sometimes be spoiled, and little baby Christians can sometimes be spoiled. But that's characteristics of a child. But, you know, just as a little child physically is not to remain in that condition, a child of God is not to remain in that baby state all their life. But I'm afraid to say, a whole lot of times we see baby Christians that have been saved 30 and 40 and 50 years because they've never grown. They've never taken things into their life, if you will, that help them grow. What helps a child to grow? The food that it takes in, the milk and the nourishment, all the things. It helps it to grow. And boy, we as God's children, we need nourishment each and every day. If we don't get God's Word and God's nourishment that He has for us as His children, we'll die. We'll starve to death spiritually. See, God wants us to grow up. He doesn't want us to stay in that condition. Hold your place right there in Exodus chapter 8. We'll be back there in just a little bit. And flip over to Ephesians chapter number 4. Ephesians chapter number 4 and verse number 7. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 7, if I've got the right verse here. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. And skip down to verse number 11. And He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints. Now, that doesn't mean we'll ever get to be perfect. That means to be complete or mature. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. God's got a work for every one of us. He wants us to grow up and be mature Christians so that He can use us in the work of the ministry for the edifying of the body till we all, not just a few, not just the evangelists, the preachers, the missionaries, the Sunday school teachers, the bus workers, that we all come in the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man. That word perfect means a complete or full grown up. Unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more, what's that next word? children. See, God doesn't want us to stay in that state. He understands when we first get saved, we're a babe in Christ. We're a child. We can expect young Christians to act and do and say and the way they did because they're babes. They need to grow. We all need to grow. He said that henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and the cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Verse 15, but speaking the truth in love, listen, look at this, may grow up into Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. God wants us to grow up. And He wants us to grow up in Christ. Amen. Have you ever asked any child or a young person, what do you want to be when you grow up? And they'll tell you, doctor, lawyer, whatever. You know, what do you want to be when you grow up as a Christian? I want to be just like Jesus. That ought to be our desire. Shouldn't that be our desire to be just like Him? When I grow up, I want to be just like Christ. That ought to be our goal and that ought to be our desire. And Paul wrote this to the Ephesian church. They were struggling growing up. And you know, we're not in a romper room. This is a battlefield. We've been enlisted in the army of God and God needs some men. He doesn't need a bunch of children. It's understandable for a child to be a child for a little bit. But there ought to be a growing process. And you know, it ought to be a daily growing process. If a child physically doesn't grow, something is wrong. There's a problem somewhere. And if a child of God does not grow spiritually, there's a problem somewhere. Boy, we all need to grow up. Amen. We do. Every one of us. Oh, preacher, I done arrived. I'm just a spiritual. I'm God's gift. You tell that lie. Every one of us need help. Every one of us basically are little children. We all need to grow up. And I think one reason we see our nation and our world in such a pitiful and ungodly shape is because we as God's people, we just hadn't grown up the way we need to. And we just need to get a handle on that growth. And we need to take a growth spurt, amen, and grow up for the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, may grow up into Him. And then verse 21 down through verse 24, it says, if so be that ye have heard Him and have been taught by Him as the truth is in Jesus, that ye put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. So we're to put off that old way, put off those old fleshly desires, put off all that old life. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And to put on the new man, grow up. And I guess God is wanting to tell us, as His people, it's high time we grow up. It's high time we get out of the nursery. It's high time we get out of the romper room. It's high time we get out of kindergarten and press forward and be a useful tool, a useful soldier in the army of God. And that goes for every single one of us. Now, take your Bible and turn to the book of 1 Corinthians real quickly. We're just about to get back to the message. This is just a little introduction to the message. But over there in 1 Corinthians chapter number 13, the love chapter. Oh, he's going to preach on love now. He's going to preach about that. Oh, we're so wonderful and God loves us so much. And He really does. God loves us. If He didn't love us, He wouldn't put up with all the junk that we do in our life when we should be growing up. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse number 11. As Paul is writing this here to a church that struggles with the flesh. Verse number 11. He said, now Paul's talking about himself. He's giving them a little testimony of himself. He said, when I was a child. Now that word child means to be simple-minded or a immature Christian. Look it up in the Strong's. That's what it is. That's the definition of that Greek word for child there. Simple-minded or immature Christian. He said, when I was a child or an immature Christian, a babe in Christ, I spake as a child. Have you ever heard brand new Christians say something that that you know you thought, oh my goodness? I remember when we was at Friendship, Friendship Baptist Church was made up of what, 95% of brand new Christians, all of them probably within the age of 20 to 40, somewhere in there. And all they's just glad they didn't have to go to hell. I mean, you know, they're just rough, redneck. And I remember this one dude up on the front one time. It got on, and I'm telling you what, people was shouting and praising God. And he didn't know what to do with himself. I mean, he just, you know, he wanted to shout, but he didn't know how to shout. He had never been around anything like that. So he just stood up, and I'm not going to say the word, but y'all can figure it out. He said, "Hoddy, that's good." You remember that? I thought, my goodness. But hey, he was a brand new Christian. He didn't know no better. You know, children will say stuff. and it didn't even miss a lick, did it? Oh, it just kept on. I tell you, because we realize that sometimes children say things. They will. He said, "When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child." That's the same Greek word. "I thought as a child. But when I became a man," or when I grew up, look what it says, "I put away childish things." Amen. Now, here comes Teddy. Now, y'all watch me sitting in that chair with my Teddy. And you probably thought that preacher has done lost his mind. He looks like a little youngin' up there holding that teddy bear. But I'm afraid to say that a whole lot of times we in our life as God's people, we're carrying around teddy bears in our life, carrying around childish things in our life, and we won't let go, we won't get rid of, we're hanging on to them because we love them. So, I love Teddy, and he's been with me all my life, and I just don't want to get rid of Teddy. He is my companion. Oh, Teddy is my comfort, and Teddy is my courage when I'm frightened. Hey, we have all that in Jesus. Woo! But we hang on to the teddy bears in our life. We won't grow up. Oh, preacher, you just have to understand. No, we don't understand when somebody don't grow up and remains a child. If my little grandyoungin stayed that size all the time, something would be wrong. We would have him down there testing him, see what's wrong. Maybe we need to test a bunch of us, see what's wrong with us, because we're toting teddy bears around. But what did Paul tell the church there in Corinth, that fleshly church, that church that was struggling with issues of the flesh? He said, "When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things." That don't mean I forgot about it. You know, I'm so thankful that God saved an old sinner like me. And I look back over my life as a child of God, those early days when we first got saved, and some of the silly and stupid and crazy things that I did as a Christian and that you did as a Christian, didn't know no better, but we grew. And it got to the point one day where we could just put away that, or it should be, put away those childish things and grow up in the Lord Jesus Christ, that God may use us for His glory and His honor. It's hard to use a little child. It is. Now, some of our children, I'm telling you, it amazes me that some of our children can do what they can do. But little children, very limited. Now, if I would get Landon up here to sing a song, you might hear a noise coming out, but it ain't no telling what it would be. If I got him to come up here and give a testimony, I don't know what that would take, what would happen there. But we just need to grow up. We need to put away childish things and grow up. You say, "Preacher, how can I do that? How can I grow up in the Lord? How can I get to where God wants me to be in my life? How can I live the Christian life?" I am glad you asked. Exodus chapter number 8. Exodus chapter number 8 and verse number 20. Aren't you so glad that God gives us an owner's manual? He gives us exactly what we need if we'll just go to it. He'll show us some practical lessons for living our life, that we can grow up, that we can lay aside those childish things. Don't forget about them. Count them as precious. You ought to count your life every step of the way as a child of God. Precious. Mine's precious. Boy, I look back the day I got saved and every day following. Boy, it's been precious. God has allowed us to be a part of Him moving and working and in our life and others' life. And I wouldn't trade that for $1 million. I wouldn't go back and do anything different. You say, preacher, what about the difficult days? Oh, yeah, there will be some difficult days. There were some difficult days. There will be again some difficult days. But I wouldn't trade a thing for what Jesus has done in my heart and life. Oh, I'll tell you what, the Christian life, it has been a wonderful journey. But it's time to grow up. I tell you what, America is going down the tubes. And the Republicans are not going to do it. The Democrats are not going to do it. The Independents are not going to do it. Hollywood's not going to do it. None of that crowd's going to do it. If anything takes place in America, if America turns their heart back to God, if folk get saved, it's going to be because God's people get broken and get burdened and grow up in Jesus, and we get so excited about being saved, so excited about trying to reach somebody else, get outside the doors, up and down the highways, and compel them to come in. Not just the house of God, but the family of God. Be saved by God. There's nothing like being saved, brother. I'm telling you what, I've had some wonderful experiences in my life, brother, but being saved is the greatest thing that ever happened to this old sinner. I'm telling you what, when Jesus came into my heart, felt like I was washed from the top of my head all the way down to the bottom of my feet, wicked, vile, ungodly sinner, deserving a hell. But He loved me, and He saved me, and He's equipped me. And He's equipped you. He saved you. And He wants to use each and every one of us. And He's given us some lessons, some practical lessons that we can learn as we live this Christian life. Exodus chapter 8, God is telling Moses here. He's giving him some instructions to go and perform his duty, I guess, if you will. There's five things here in verse number 20 that we're going to look at tonight. Five practical lessons for learning. And I hope it'll be a help. I hope it'll be a strength. It has me. It's helped my heart just to be able to realize that if I'll do these things, that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The God that was with Moses is the God that will be with us. He'll never leave. He'll never forsake. When we think all is about to fall apart, here He comes down the road. But I'll go on to say, He ain't down the road. He's right here with us each and every step of the way. Five practical lessons for living. The first practical lesson that we need to learn is that lesson of discipline. Look what He told Moses. He said, "And the Lord said unto Moses, rise up early in the morning." You know what that means? That means up and at them. That means we don't need to dilly-dally around. We don't need to poke around. We need to get up out of the bed, get busy serving God each and every day. He's given us opportunities. He's given us responsibilities. And we need to be busy about God's work. We need to have some discipline about our Bible study. We need to have some discipline about our prayer life. We need to have some discipline about our witness, our soul winning. We need to have some discipline about the way we live, the way we walk, the way we talk. We need discipline in our life. He told him, he said, "Moses, you rise up early in the morning. Get at it. Get busy and serve me. I have a job for you to do. The Christian life is not for lazy folk." "Well, preacher, I just like laying in the bed in the morning." I wish I could. I can't lay in the bed anymore. I done got the place now. If I lay in the bed, I can't get out of the bed. Yeah, you throw your feet out and, "Oh, God, oh Lord, what's going to hurt now?" Yeah, so I just might as well get on up. But we just need to be disciplined in our life. Amen. We do. You know, we'll never be a useful vessel in God's hands like He wants us to be if we're just haphazard, just whatever, and if we're not disciplined. We need discipline in our life. A child needs discipline. If a child's left to themselves, what's going to happen? Oh, it's going to be a mess. You look at our public school system now, you see what happens when they're left to themselves, when you cannot discipline them, you can't do anything, and they just run wild and run amok. Well, you know, I'm afraid a whole lot of Christians is running wild and running amok. We need discipline. He said, rise up early in the morning. First practical lesson to grow, to lay aside those childish things, is to be disciplined. If we're going to be what God wants us to be, we need to have discipline in our life. Discipline in our life, in everything we do. You know, when you go into the military, Brother David, when you went into the military, one of the first things they taught you is discipline. Because you can't be a good soldier if you're not, Brother Michael, you know, if you don't have discipline in your life, you will not make it as a soldier. And God wants some soldiers that He can use for His glory. We need discipline. He said, rise up early in the morning. Not only the practical lesson for living of discipline, but that lesson of duty. Look what it says. Rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh. He said, I want you to go down there and stand before the king. Now, that was not an easy thing to do. And you know, there's some things that God calls us to do that are not easy things to do. But we have a duty. We have a responsibility. God has told us that we're to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And you know, sometimes that is a difficult thing. When we begin to talk to our friends, sometimes we're afraid what they're going to say and how they're going to respond and will they like us anymore. And when we talk to our family, you know, they know what we were before we got saved. Oh, yeah, you're not real. I remember what you know, our duty is not an easy thing. Down at the workplace, when we try to talk to our coworkers, that's not an easy thing to do. I remember I used to work at the post office in Burlington, and sometimes in the morning we'd be in there sorting the mail, and it would get a little rough in there. Oh, they'd be cussing back and forth at one another and all kind of mess. And every once in a while, I'd stick my head out the case. I said, all right, y'all play nice now. And they calm down. And before I left the post office, I had an opportunity to talk to each and every one of them. And I'm so thankful that God will use us if we'll just perform our duty. You know, we can't reach the world, but God has placed us in a realm of folk that we're come in contact with on a daily basis, and we have a duty to reach them with the gospel. There may be nobody else that can. And that duty is not always a easy thing, but the Bible says that we're to endure hardness as a good soldier of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, and even folk that are famous, sometimes it's hard. You know, celebrities or folk that are high positions, it's hard to talk to them about the Lord. Hey, we just need to get past all that. Realize we have a duty to perform. Have discipline in our life. And perform our duty, no matter how hard it was. You know, I imagine Moses thought, well, you know, here's Pharaoh, and Pharaoh is the most powerful individual in the world. And if I go down there and make him mad, there's no telling what he'll do. He'll probably kill me, feed me to the crocodiles, or whatever. But he said, rise up early in the morning, and I want you to stand before him. If we have an opportunity to stand before somebody and give them the gospel and tell them how much Jesus loves them and how much He went through to pay the price for our sins, will we perform our duty? Or will we back down and be scared? You know that old word, scared? Preacher, I never got scared. You tell that lie. We all have. You know why? Because we're still little children. We grow up and be full-grown soldiers in God's army, have some discipline, realize our duty, and get busy about it. God will give us what we need. Paul said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Practical lesson, discipline. Practical lesson, duty here. Stand before Pharaoh. And then a practical lesson of diligence. Look what it says. Stand before Pharaoh, lo, he cometh forth to the water. God said, I want you to get down there. You get up out of the bed. You go down there. And I want you to stand before Pharaoh. And I want you to get there before he leaves. You know, there's, I don't know how many in my life, opportunities that I've missed because I wasn't faithful. Because I was a little child, I guess. because I just hadn't grown up and trusted God enough. He said, I want you to go down there before you miss that opportunity. We need to have diligence in our life. We need to be so sensitive, and we need to ask God, Lord, help me to be so sensitive in my life that I won't miss any opportunity that you open, a door that you open, an opportunity to tell somebody about the Lord. Lord, help me to just be diligent in my service for you. I don't want to miss any. He said, look, you better get down there. He's going down there to the water, and if you miss that opportunity, you may not ever have it again. And I've missed opportunities like that before. Lord, I'll talk to them tomorrow. Lord, next week will be a better time, and I'll talk to them. And sometimes next week never comes. We need to be diligent. Rise up early. Have discipline. Stand before Pharaoh. Duty. It's not always easy. Learn that lesson. Diligence. Seize opportunities while they're at hand. And then the practical lesson of declaration. Lo, he cometh forth to the water, and say unto him, thus saith the Lord. You know, it seems like we don't have any bit of problem talking to somebody about sports, about fishing, about hunting, about our vehicles, about our house, about our home, about our guns, about this and about that. We don't have any problem talking about that. But sometimes it just seems like we struggle talking to people about the Lord. I can understand a child doing that, but why should we do that? If we're grown up in the Lord, if we're a soldier in His army, there ought to be some declaration. He told him, said, Moses, I want you to go down there. And before he leaves, I want you to go down there and stand before him. And I want you to say unto him, thus saith the Lord. And we need to have the right message. We need to be, let me add this, we need to be listening to the right message today. You know, we listen to the media. Boy, we're going to get some of that false message today. You know, Hollywood tries to teach us about morals. Our political realm, they try to teach us about corruption and power grabbing. Our business tries to teach us about covetousness. But I tell you what, we need to study this precious word, and we need to find out what God wants to tell us, and we need to say, thus saith the Lord. You know, all these ills and all these sins of our society, we need to preach on those. But the number one thing that we need to be telling, thus saith the Lord, is that Jesus saves. And it's a whosoever will salvation. You know, what we see in society, the homosexuals and the drug addicts and the alcoholics and the thieves and the murderers and the rapists and all that, that's just a symptom of sin. That's all it is. It is a symptom of sin, of a heart problem, and the only thing that'll change that is Jesus. He'll change that heart. And so the declaration, he wanted him to go down to the water and say, thus saith the Lord. And he was going to give the message. We ought to give the right message, thus saith the Lord. We have the right message. We have this old King James Bible. Anything else is a perversion thereof. Ought to cast it aside and stick with God's precious word and say, thus saith the Lord. The right message. When was the last time you told somebody about Jesus? Well, preacher, that's your responsibility. That's the missionary's responsibility. That's the Sunday school teacher's responsibility. That's the bus worker's responsibility. That's so-and-so's responsibility. That's not my responsibility because I'm a little child. What kind of excuse is that? You know, one day we're going to have to stand before God and give an account of our life. And how you reckon that would fly? Lord, I was a little young and I never growed up. I didn't want to grow up. I was just having fun. Lord, I just having fun. I just having fun in my life. And I like Teddy. I don't want to give him up. I got to. I know I'm saved. I know I don't have to go to hell, but I sure do love Teddy. Oh, I don't want to give up Teddy. And I just don't want to grow up. Some of y'all like being children. You like being a child. You like being a youngin'. You like being a little boy. You tell that lie. When I was a little little boy, I enjoyed it like nothing else. I mean, I had a ball. No responsibilities, no bills. I played all the time, and I just hung on to Teddy. Well, I'm afraid there's a whole lot of God's people, that's what's happening. We hanging on to Teddy. And folk are going to hell because we hanging on to Teddy. You know, Paul said, when I became a man, I put away childish things. And we need to grow up. God's given us lessons. He said, Moses, I want you to go down there and say, thus saith the Lord. God has given us a command to preach the gospel to every creature. Thus saith the Lord. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. That's the most important thing. Sin is bad. Sin is wicked. Sin is vile. God hates sin. But God loves sinners and He wants them to be saved. And He's given us the blessed opportunity, the blessed privilege and honor to tell somebody about Jesus that they might get saved. Declaration. There ought to be some declaration in our life as we grow up. Declaration. Somebody has to open their mouth. You know, years ago they had this thing that was very popular. I don't know if some of y'all remember that. Lifestyle evangelism. Y'all ever heard that? You know, that's good in a sense, I guess. You know, we need to be able to look at somebody's life and see the demonstration of Christ in their life. We need to see that. That's part of growing up. But if nobody ever opens their mouth, how will anybody ever know how to be saved? The Bible says, faith cometh by what? Hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So there needs to be a declaration. These lessons here in one verse. He said, Moses, you rise up early in the morning, you be disciplined, and you stand before Pharaoh. That's a duty that you need to perform. Whether it's easy or not, we need to just stand for the Lord in our day. We need to have some diligence, learn that lesson well. Lo, we cometh forth to the water. Don't miss opportunities. God gives us each and every day opportunities to witness, opportunities to worship Him, opportunities to reach folk with the gospel, and we don't need to be slack on our responsibility. We need to take every opportunity to tell somebody about Jesus. And then there's the declaration. We have to open our mouth. We have practical things that'll help us grow up as a Christian. And then lastly tonight, we need to learn the lesson about devotion. Look what it said. He said, say unto him, thus saith the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. We ought to have a devotion like none other. Amen. We need to realize where we were at. See, in this story here, Moses there, and he was going before Pharaoh. Egypt, if you will, is a picture of the world. Pharaoh is a picture of the devil. And Moses is a picture of the child of God. He said, you just go to him. You go to the devil, if you will, amen, and say, let my people go. He's lost. He's in the bonds of sin, and he needs Jesus, and just let him go, you sorry rascal. How many of y'all ever pray for somebody that they get saved? You know, the devil's got a hold of them. He's got them blinded. Hey, we need to have some devotion in our life that they may serve me. The reason we go out there and reach them is so God will change their life to honor and worship and serve him. You know, one Christian makes another Christian, and another Christian makes another Christian, and that's the way God builds His church. That's the way He builds His family and His army. Devotion to serve me. But I'm afraid sometimes we serve God out of selfish reasons. Hey, well, Lord, if you help me get past this sickness, I'll serve you more. And then when we get past the sickness, we're down at the lake or down at the racetrack. Or, Lord, if you help me with my finances, and you know, I don't have a whole lot of money, and Lord, if you help me with that, boy, I'll give more to you. And God helps us with that, and then we go buy a lottery ticket. Where's our devotion? Oh, we just need to love Him. I tell you what, we just need to get past our childish things and just grow up in the Lord, into Him. That's what Paul said. I want to grow up, be just like Jesus. And we're going to have to take some lessons, some practical lessons about discipline, about duty, about diligence, about declaration. I think that's a hard lesson for God's people. Hard lesson. We don't want to open our mouth. Somebody's got to tell somebody about Jesus. And then devotion. If we had the devotion for Him the way we need to have for Him, oh, we'd serve Him every day. It wouldn't be a problem. Oh, we would grow up because we wanted to be just like Him. Hey, we would love Him and serve Him with all our heart. Lessons for living. Lessons, practical lessons for living. We need to just get past. We just need to get past Teddy. And we need to get in that Word of God. We need to get on our knees. And we need to say, Lord, help me in 2017 to grow up. Lord, I know I've been saved 10, 15, 20, 30, 40 years. I know I've been saved all these years. But Lord, I just need to grow up. Did you realize none of us will ever be grown until we get home? It's a continual growing process. But we need to grow. And we just need to lay aside the childish things as a Christian and let God do a work in our heart. Because there's a lost and dying world outside these doors that needs some grown-up Christians. Grown-up Christians to go to them and say, let me tell you about the one that can change your life. As we're standing at our feet all over the building this evening, every head bowed, every eye closed, I'm so thankful that God doesn't throw the clay away. I'm so thankful that God has such patience with us. The times we fail Him, the times we let Him down, the times we grieve His heart. But He understands we're children and we need to grow. But we need to grow. We need to grow. We don't need to stop growing. Every day we need to grow. As Brother James begins to play, Miss Amy begins to play, and Brother James, whatever you're going to do, this old-fashioned altar's open. You know, there's so many folk that still need to be saved. So many folk that still need the gospel. And we cannot do it in our own strength. We cannot reach folk in our flesh. We need His power. We need God's touch upon our lives. And we just need to grow up. Say, preacher, I don't know if I want to grow up. Jesus wants you to grow up. This old-fashioned altar is open. Maybe you just need to come and say, Lord, help me to be a better Christian. Help me. That ought to be the desire of every child of God. Help me grow up. Help me to be better for You. Help me to reach a lost and dying world. Give me a burden. Give me a brokenness of heart. Folk dying and on their way to hell, and somebody needs to reach them. Help me to be a better Christian this coming year. Maybe that's you. Or maybe you're here this evening and you don't even know Jesus as your personal Savior. There's never been a time in your life that you realized you were a sinner, realized Jesus died for you, and invited Him into your heart. Forgive you of your sins. Maybe you're not saved. If that's you, this old-fashioned altar's open. If you come down here, somebody will take the Word of God and we'll show you how you can know for sure that you're saved. This old-fashioned altar's open. Lord, help us to be better Christians.
I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Are you satisfied with your life as a child of God? You feel like you don't need to grow up? Are you already arrived? Well, I sure have. I need all the help I can get. A whole lot of times I feel like just a little youngin' in God's sight. I feel like I fail Him so many times and let Him down. Lord, I just want to be a better Christian.
I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather.
How about you? This old-fashioned altar still open. Still time while these pray. Preacher, I'm afraid somebody think bad of me. Hey, they won't think bad of you. Hey, we're all in the same boat. We're all in the same army, those of us that are saved.
Or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus.
Amen. While these are finishing up praying, we just want to praise the Lord for His goodness to us, praise Him for loving us the way He does, never giving up on us, even when we toting teddies around. And, you know, God, I'm sure many times looks at us and says, I don't understand why I have to grow up. Let's put childish things aside. Get God's precious word. So, Lord, help me. Teach me. Mold my life, shape me, and then use me for your glory and for your honor. Amen. Practical lessons. Let's grow up in Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, it's been good being here tonight. I hope you got something out of the service. I hope you didn't focus on the little teddy bear. but that was a good illustration. We hang on to a whole lot of things in our life we all let go. You know, we don't need to continue to hang on to childish things. If I'd tote that thing around all the time, what would y'all think about me? If I walk around this ministry all the time like this, what would you think? That preacher, he needs to grow up. I do. We do. If we're going to accomplish anything for the Lord Jesus Christ, we need to grow up. Amen. All right, well, let's go ahead and close in prayer. And Brother Alex, I want you to come, and I want you to close in prayer. And just ask God to continue to move and bless here at Calvary. Help us to be all we can for Him.
Lord, we love you, God. We thank you, Lord, for another day. We thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to be able to be back in your house. God, appreciate the good message. Thank you, Lord, for everything that our hearts have felt. God, touch preacher, Lord, as he's away. God, I pray, Lord, you give him a safe trip back. Bring us back, Lord, for Wednesday. Lord, thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done around this place, Lord, here. Pray, Lord, you continue to work, God, and touch here one more time and meet with us, Lord, here on Wednesday night. God, we'll give you the honor, praise, and glory, Lord, for it all. In Jesus' name, amen.